So Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
It is my favorite holiday of the entire church year. I'm probably not going to grow out of that at this point. I'm 58 years old and I'm still a kid at Christmas to rejoice that the Lord Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem, right? That God, who had promised the Messiah, what? Sent the Messiah. That's a wonderful thing, right? Now, here's the hard thing about being a preacher on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. You already know the story, right? So what am I supposed to say 2,000 years after the church has said over and over again that the Messiah is born and the Savior has come? God has kept his word. So I sometimes speak to my wife about such things. What should I do with the sermon tonight? And you know what she said? She said, you should keep it short. So I do want to say a few things tonight about it. You do know the story. I hope that dwells in our hearts. But I'm going to give you my outline right here. I want us to know about the historical reality of the birth of Jesus. But I also want us to know about the spiritual necessity of the birth of Jesus. And then lastly, I want us to know about the continuing necessity of the birth of Jesus. All right. So here's the historical reality. And with my marching orders to keep it short, I'm not going to repeat all of last year's sermon, but you remember last Christmas Eve was my first Christmas here, and so I preached that sermon that lists a bunch of Old Testament passages, and I don't expect you to memorize them, but last year I preached a sermon with 21 different Old Testament passages to point that over and over again, some of them 1,000 years before Jesus was born, some of them 700 years before he was born, saying things like that will be born of a virgin, Isaiah 7, that will be born in Bethlehem, right, chapter 5, etc. Right, that he would die on the cross, Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me, right? All these verses, and the point I was saying is that all these Old Testament things point to this one man, and this is my point. If not Jesus, then who else would it be, right? Who else was born of a virgin in Bethlehem, was crucified, who raised the dead, who healed the sick, who gave sight to the blind, who preached the gospel before, who rose again on the third day of his crucifixion. Who else would that be? Just Jesus. So last year I preached 21 Old Testament passages about the birth of Jesus, and this year I decided to look it up. People talk about how many different Old Testament passages point to Jesus, and some are very clear, right? Isaiah 7, the whole version, what we see, that's where Jesus died. But some are very much kind of a hint, right? Some of them are pretty subtle, and so if you count them all up, people will say somewhere between 350 and 400 passages the Old Testament point to Jesus. Now, the reason I say that, I want you to know the historical reality of Jesus, because you live in a world of skepticism, right? We live in a world where people just very quickly say, well, the Bible's full of errors. Well, the Bible is wrong about this. The Bible was written a long time ago. We're not sure about some of what the Bible says. And so Christians sort of feel like, how sure are we? This is when I say the historical reality, I don't want to be just a history lesson, but I want you to know that you ought to be absolutely certain that Jesus is the Son of God, the one who fulfills 350 Old Testament passages. That's a lot more than 21, right? I just did 21 last year, because I assume you didn't want 350. But can you imagine that? And I wanted us to know that Jesus, and Jesus alone, right, Jesus and nobody else, is that one. Because they certainly do it every Easter, but sometimes they do it at Christmas. Somebody on TV will interview one of the modern scholars, right? And some of the new scholarship isn't really scholarship, it's just people making hay. And so sometimes the person on the TV isn't a believer, and they call on the expert who isn't a believer, and this guy says, tell me about the new scholarship, and this guy says, well, there's all kinds of problems in the Bible. And because that's the truth, your job as a modern-day, high-functioning Christian, I hate to say this, but it is, your job is discernment. Because that scholar doesn't come on and say, I'm about to attack the Bible. They say, this is a biblical scholar. So you need to discern. And you know how you learn to discern? You read. Read your Bible above all else, but other commentators you can trust. And you read, and you do more reading. I mean, you think you've done all the reading you could possibly do. You know what you should do? Read some more. Because we want to know the certainty this Christ, this Jesus, is our Savior. Now, the second thing I want to know about is the spiritual necessity of the birth of Jesus. While I'm talking about this, you can take out your bulletin and put back to page 4. We're going to look at something in just a minute. But the spiritual necessity, you have to get to this, right? Why was Jesus born? To die, right? It's just that simple. Jesus was born to die. And I'm like everyone, I love Christmas. I love the decorations. I love Christmas hymns. They're perfect and not easy, right? They're joyful. I love the tree. I love the gifts. I still do. I love finding a good gift. That's a special thing, right? How about, have you had that thing this year with like all the confusion about the mail? Renee told me my gift will be here in January. That's all right. Christmas will be 30 days in my house. That's all right. I love all that. But you want to know this, that when the angels were singing and the people were celebrating, it wasn't just a birth announcement, right? It just wasn't, hey, it's a miraculous thing, a baby is born. Every baby is a miracle, right? Of course. But this baby was not just being celebrated, being born, but this baby is being born to go to the cross. And I don't want to dwell on that home, but I want to think that. Think there's right on top of each other. Think Christmas and cross. And Christmas and what? And cross. And I love it when the hymn writers get this right. My favorite Christmas hymn is What Child Is This? It's beautiful. I get emotional singing it. But, and we've sung it already. But just to draw our attention to how wonderful this is expressed here, I would like us as a congregation tonight to read together stanza 2. Stanza 2. To read out loud, to think about what you're reading. You just sung it. It's a beautiful piece. To hear how wonderfully the gospel is captured here. Let's read together.
Why lies he in such mean state, where ox and ass are feeding? Good Christian, fear, for sinners dear, the silent word is fleeting. Nails and spear shall pierce him through, the cross be borne for me, for you. Hail, hail, the word made flesh, the babe, the son.
There's wonderful words and wonderful hymns of course, but I can't help it. Every Christmas I think, nails, spears will pierce me through this baby. That's my companion. Now I don't want us to do, some of you lay this on too thick as pastors, will sort of say, your sin sent Jesus to the cross. Have you heard that sermon? I don't like that sermon. It's too heavy. There's a truth there, I understand. But our sin sent Jesus to the cross. It's really Jesus wanting to go to the cross to save you from your sins, right? That's the way to say it, right? Not just the heavy or guilty thing. But Jesus chose this. God, think of this. God, before he even made us, knew we sinned. Isn't that right? Why did he do it? God knew before he made us that mankind would fall into sin, and if we fell into sin, he'd have to save us. And in salvation, wouldn't be by us getting better, but would be by the death of the Son. If there was another way, God would have done that way. So you know what that means? This was the way. That God made us out of grace and mercy to love us. And to love us enough, sent the Son. And the Son said, I'll go. We can often ask, do I know that God loved me? Yes. Why don't I really love him? Christmas. Cross. And of course, cross is Easter. Jerry says. As soon as we say, he went to the cross, he rose again. And by the way, it's coming. So, that's the spiritual necessity of it. But I want us to get this last thing I want us to think about tonight, is the continuing necessity to celebrate the birth of the Savior. We all know it's 2020, right? I think they've been experiencing it for the last 9 months. And this is the thing that has started to be said. Some politicians have said, we need to cancel Christmas. We need to cancel Christmas. And every time I hear that, I always think, you know, there was a man who tried to cancel Christmas. Do you know what his name is? King Herod. Right? King Herod said, I'm not down with this new king thing. And so Herod decided to cancel Christmas. How did that go? Not very well for him. That's, you know, good for us, right? But you can't cancel Christmas. This is especially what I like, though. Some politicians say that you shouldn't travel or spend time with your family, and right after that, you have a picture of them traveling, spending time with their family. Isn't that wonderful? I don't want to go political here, right? I hope that doesn't sound like an editorial, but I want to make it clear that we don't cancel Christmas. Jesus is born, am I right? Herod didn't cancel it. No politician didn't cancel Christmas. Jesus is born. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, went to the crossroads, and then he didn't cancel Christmas. Those are perpetually true, and this is the thing, that they're perpetually true because we need that. In this place, and some folks are watching online, and that's the way it ought to be too. People have different places where they are and what their needs are right now. I understand that some people can watch it recorded, and Lord bless them. But it's wonderful to be in the Lord's house, to sing the songs, to hear the scriptures. It's not painful. We need to have Christmas, not as a historical event, not just to say, Jesus lived and died a long time ago. A pastor preached about it last year. I'm sure that it's true. There's a place for that. That's why I'm sure that it is true. But I need to know that in 2020, Jesus was born, died, rose, and lives. To all time. For me. That would change things, right? Maybe it'll change things. You guys know that you've heard 100 sermons over your lifespan. What is the first thing an angel says? Fear not. In a couple of our readings, we had that. Mary, don't be afraid. Shepherds, don't be afraid. There's some over in Matthew, too, that Joseph, don't be afraid. Hey, church, guess what God's message is? Don't be afraid. There's a new year coming, right? How should you enter that year? Joyfully. Fight for God. Fight for God. For it is not the same. It's still true. It's true before. It's still true. But not be fearful. You're poor in the strength of the Lord. And you're not sure about the reason Mary's not in the top. Couple of us.